Bantam Doubleday Dell Audio Publishing presents The Shelter of Each Other by Mary Pipher, PhD.
When my son was 10 and my daughter 4, we camped at Bluestem Lake. In the afternoon, Zeke landed a 12-inch bass and Sarah rescued a frog. While my husband played his guitar under a cottonwood, I lay reading on the shore. For dinner, we ate hamburgers and beans. In the dark, we roasted marshmallows around a fire. We listened to cicadas and the motor of a small boat. A moon, the shape and color of a pumpkin, rose over the lake. Sarah snuggled into her father and said something so beautiful that I can quote it 15 years later. She said, "I'm melting into richness." Zeke told us about a boy in his karate class who supposedly saved his mother from a mugger. He told us that he fell asleep nights hoping a robber would break in. He said, "Nothing would make me happier than saving our family from bad guys." As I watched the stars come out and the moon climb into the sky, I thought about 4 million years of families. Lucky families had always had days like this, days outdoors fishing and swimming, feeling wind and sun, and later eating together by a fire. A coyote wailed in the distance. I talked about the baby coyotes I had for pets when I was young. Jim played guitar and Zeke stirred the fire. I wanted to stop time and keep us this way forever. I felt the ghosts of a million mothers, each of whom must have had this same thought. Magical moments are embedded in ordinary life. The joys and sorrows of family are as mixed together and inseparable as salt and pepper. Those same children who delighted me around the campfire drove me wild a few years later when they were teens. I have memories of sad and crazy times in both my family of origin and my current family. As a child, I was upset by family problems, and as an adult, I have lost a great deal of sleep worrying about my children. But I prefer to recall the happy memories. I remember the day my husband invented car dancing. We were driving through snow to Minneapolis. The children were tired of car games and of each other. Jim put on a Van Morrison tape and announced a car dancing competition. As Van sang, Jim twisted and swayed as much as he could while driving. Soon the kids were dancing in their seatbelts and raising their hands high. We crooned our way across the Middle Raccoon River in Iowa as the sun went down. By the time we got to Minnesota, we had all won the dance contest. When I was 5, my cousin Steve taught me how to fish near his Ozark home. He baited my hook and took off the bluegills and perch that I pulled in, one after another. I remember Sunday dinners at my grandparents' home in eastern Colorado. 20 people gathered around a table heaped with chicken, roast beef, homemade biscuits, and watermelon pickles. My grandfather said grace, and my grandmother poured tea into tall, sweaty glasses. I remember my mother in the 1950s driving to see her patients along country roads and telling stories of her childhood. And I can see my Aunt Betty crawling through the Idaho woods for huckleberries to make pies. At a family reunion, I looked at pictures of my father and his mother, both of whom died long ago. My father's eyes reminded me of my son's. My daughter's body was that of my grandmother. Talking on the porch late into the night with my brothers, we had the same 40-year-old memories of snapping turtle soup and black beans around a smoky campfire. Since I was a little girl, I have struggled to make sense of my family, which was noisy, complicated, and filled with intense emotional people. They argued about politics and religion and made diverse decisions about love and work. I tried to figure out how everyone was wired. Why did certain people fall in love? Why was one cousin spoiled and hard to get along with, and another wonderfully patient with his younger siblings? Why did one uncle drink so much? Why did one family forbid rock and roll? When I went to college, I majored in anthropology. I wanted to understand why we do what we do. How do cultures get organized in certain ways? Who makes the rules? How does my family's Irish and Scottish heritage and poor rural background affect our point of view? Later, I went to graduate school in psychology and became a therapist. My adult work is really the continuation of a lifelong quest to figure out what the deal is. The answers are complicated, elusive, and partial. Honest parents don't always raise honest kids. Abusive parents sometimes have wonderful children. One of the most wholesome girls I know lives with her alcoholic mother in a small apartment. Some of the unhappiest children I know come from the families of sensitive, child-focused parents. Children who are loved and protected sometimes grow up strong and well-adjusted, and sometimes they grow into hothouse flowers who suffer from the Princess and the Pea syndrome. Children who are ignored sometimes grow as strong and beautiful and resilient as sunflowers, and sometimes they grow into dangerous psychopaths. Well-meaning families sometimes have extraordinarily bad luck with their children, while slapdash parents may raise highly successful children. Not all families are healthy, and not all parents good at their jobs. I have seen terrible things happen in families. I've seen hate-filled, violent families, families with addictions, families in which the parents were not grown-ups and the children had no childhoods, and families in which the children were starving for moral nourishment. I know how destructive families can be, how stifling and riddled with pain, but I also know that this is not the whole or even the most interesting part of the story. Families are ancient institutions. Since humans crossed the savannas in search of food, our families have been unique. We are born helpless and dependent. Unlike monkeys who can run around within hours of birth and are self-sufficient within a few months, it takes humans in even the simplest environments more than a decade to be independent of parents. Homo sapiens need families to survive. We need our families, but we don't always behave well in them. We love and hate them, yearn for them deep in our bones, and feel so disgusted with them that we want to spit. Like all interesting and important phenomena, jazz, Shakespeare, or Zen, families are sad and happy, complicated and simple, and full of victories and failures. It's impossible to capture the diversity or complexity of families. I'll attempt something considerably less ambitious, to explore how our culture affects the mental health of families that I know. You will hear stories about the families I see in my Midwestern city. My goal is to encourage discussions about what families need. I discuss fewer solutions than I do problems. I believe the solutions will be found family by family and community by community. This program sympathizes with families' efforts to survive a difficult era. It is for the vast majority of parents who are trying hard to do the right thing. My goal is to help listeners be anthropologists who look at the broader culture and ask, how does American culture affect the life of my family? What values does it teach? What behaviors does it influence? How does it define what is good and important? I want to help families become more conscious of how they are shaped by the culture in which they live. I write about families because I love them. When I travel alone, far from home, I think of my children's faces to calm myself down. I picture them smiling, studying, playing violin or volleyball. I picture my husband's face, bent over his guitar, or relaxed and fresh, as it is on the mornings when we drink coffee together on the front porch. Those faces are my mandalas. They comfort and secure me. The faces of those we love are the first, the primal mandalas for us all.
Part 1. The Crisis. Thirsty in the rain. We have a 6-foot corn plant in our office waiting room. It's not a good environment for a plant. There are no windows, little kids tear off its leaves, and we therapists, who are known for our nurturing abilities, keep forgetting to water it and dust its leaves. Sometime in the late 1980s, we gave it plant food. But month after month, as old leaves turn brown and drop off, fresh green leaves sprout from its center. The corn plant is a good metaphor for families. It's plain, not at all exotic or even attractive, and it's in a hostile environment. But it's surviving. Our culture is at war with families. Families in America have been invaded by technology, mocked or kitschified by the media, isolated by demographic changes, pounded by economic forces, and hurt by corporate values. They have been frightened by crime in their neighborhoods. Parents worry about their children.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.